And a Fox News alert, the deal is done. World leaders in Iran ending three decades of mostly diplomatic gridlock, making history last night by reaching an interim deal that calls on Tehran to cut down on its nuclear activity in exchange for sanctions relief. Critics are already speaking out, and some are calling the deal dubious at best, others describing it as downright dangerous. Good morning, everyone. We welcome you here to America's News Headquarters. I'm Jamie Colby.
Good morning, Jamie, and good morning, everyone. I'm Eric Shawn. This agreement, of course, was announced at 3 o'clock in the morning, and it comes after weeks of intense negotiations in Geneva. Well, now the two sides have 6 months to try and hammer out a more comprehensive deal that could potentially solve the dispute over Iran's nuclear intentions. But is this really the first step in trying to stop a possible Iranian nuclear bomb? President Obama praised the development last night.
Today, that diplomacy opened up a new path toward a world that is more secure, a future in which we can verify that Iran's nuclear program is peaceful and that it cannot build a nuclear weapon.
Well, already there is criticism that it's not enough, and we have Team Fox coverage. Jennifer Griffin in our Washington Bureau, but we begin with Peter Doocy, who's live at the White House. Hello, Peter.
Hi, Eric. And last night we got a very rare, very late Saturday night statement from President Obama where he explained that his job as commander-in-chief is to try to resolve our differences with Iran peacefully. He thinks this agreement is a way to do that. And here are the basics of the deal. Iran has agreed to freeze its nuclear program for 6 months in exchange for about $7 billion in economic relief, mostly from eased sanctions.
The United States and our friends and allies have agreed to provide Iran with modest relief while continuing to apply our toughest sanctions. We will refrain from imposing new sanctions, and we will allow the Iranian government access to a portion of the revenue that they have been denied through sanctions.
White House officials on a conference call detailed that economic relief like this. They say, quote, the deal that was struck is very limited in terms of the additional business that Iran can engage in. It's able to sell petrochemicals and able to sell and export automobiles. That's it. Full stop. There's no other business activity that is permitted under this first step deal with Iran. And if at any point in the next 6 months, Iran is caught building a nuclear weapon, the deal is off and the terms are reversed. The White House says they don't think new sanctions are going to help anything right now, but some in Congress, including the top Republican on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, Tennessee Senator Bob Corker, say they are not so sure. This morning on Fox News Sunday, we heard Senator Corker say that he thinks there's going to be a bipartisan effort to make sure this is not a final agreement. And another strong congressional reaction this morning is coming from Republican Senator Marco Rubio. He said he thinks this deal shows other rogue nations that it's okay to lie to the United States for 10 years because Senator Rubio says the United States will then just get tired and negotiate with you anyway. Back to you.
Well, Peter, that was the North Korean playbook. We'll be talking about that with John Bolton in just a minute. Peter, thank you. Jamie?
Guys, thanks. Secretary of State John Kerry is applauding the deal with Iran, calling it a first step towards making our world safer, adding that if Iran's nuclear program is truly for peaceful purposes, then this is its chance to prove it. National security correspondent Jennifer Griffin joining me now live in Washington. Jen, good morning.
Good morning, Jamie. Reaction to the deal is already pouring in. Syria, Iraq, and the Palestinian Authority, all friends of Iran, welcome the deal. Iran's opponents, its other Arab neighbors, have largely remained quiet. Not so Israel.
It's not a historic agreement. It's a historic mistake. It's not made the world a safer place. Like the agreement with North Korea in 2005, this agreement has made the world a much more dangerous place.
Let me be crystal clear to Israel, to our other friends in the region, to any neighbor who feels threatened, that the next step requires proof certain, a fail-safe set of steps which eliminate the current prospect of a breakout and the creation of a nuclear weapon.
Here's what the deal includes. It halts construction of the Arak heavy water reactor, which could provide weapons-grade plutonium, a second track to a bomb. It neutralizes Iran's stockpile of uranium refined to a concentration of 20%. It suspends enrichment above a fissile purity of 5% for 6 months. Iran agrees to not add any centrifuges to the already existing cascades. It allows daily IAEA inspections at Fardo and Natanz. The deal does not require Iran to ship its current stockpile of enriched uranium out of the country, which the U.S. and others had wanted. Iran's president praised the deal, saying it recognizes Iran's nuclear rights. Iran does not give up its ability to enrich uranium. Iran will receive about $7 billion in sanctions relief during the next 6 months. It will receive $4.2 billion in frozen funds from oil sales. Nearly $100 billion of Iran's foreign exchange holdings remains frozen, however. Republicans on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, such as Senator Bob Corker of Tennessee, they are worried that Iran may fool the U.S. and still get a bomb, as North Korea did when the U.S. engaged it in multi-party talks.
My greatest concern throughout this whole situation is the North Korean issue, and that is you begin relieving sanctions, you end up basically with no deal. And so my greatest concern is seeing follow through here.
Relief from the sanctions is set to begin in 2 to 3 weeks. Iran's leadership has just issued a statement that if Congress imposes new sanctions, then the deal is off. Eric?
All right, Jennifer, thanks so much.
Thanks, Jen.
Well, does this deal delay, stop, or even encourage a possible Iranian nuclear bomb? Critics point out that their nuclear facilities still remain firmly in place and untouched. U.S. Ambassador John Bolton, Fox News contributor, former ambassador to the United Nations, and senior fellow at the American Enterprise Institute, now joins us from Washington. Ambassador, does this agreement achieve anything?
Yes, it's a huge victory for Iran. They have broken the psychological momentum of the economic sanctions. They saw that as one of their principal objectives, which they have now gained. Once this sanction regime begins to crumble, it'll be very hard to put it back in place as countries like China, South Korea, and India once again increase their legal imports of oil from Iran. And the Ayatollahs in Tehran saw something else as well. They saw that having this process in place would give Washington more leverage over Israel to prevent the one thing, and in fact, the only thing that Iran fears, and that's an Israeli military strike. So, in exchange for superficial, easily reversible concessions on the nuclear program, Iran has gained time, legitimacy, relief from the economic sanctions, and probably relief from an Israeli strike. A huge win for Iran.
Is this the same thing that North Korea did during the Clinton administration back in the 1990s?
Yeah, well, North Korea did this on multiple occasions. It did it to the Bush administration, too, with the Bush administration embarrassingly removing North Korea from the list of state sponsors of terrorism, opening North Korea's access to international financial markets. Didn't change a thing. North Korea exploded two nuclear devices after that relief from sanctions. Because what Iran sees, what North Korea benefited from, is that the will to sanctions in the West is weak. Let me give you one concrete example that the Obama administration faced. Countries like China, India, South Korea had already indicated they wanted to resume purchases of Iranian oil at higher levels. And under the U.S. sanctions legislation, the White House would have had two choices. One, impose sanctions on the likes of China, India, and South Korea for violating our sanctions, or two, giving additional waivers to those countries, which would have been very difficult politically. So, in a way, what Iran has done is break through the clutter and allowed itself to reestablish its commercial bona fides with some of those customers. This is a huge breakthrough.
You know, talk about the clutter. Let's take a look at what Iran is not doing. Well, everyone's touting what they are supposedly doing. The deal does not dismantle one thing. It doesn't destroy any nuclear facilities, does not remove any of the enriched uranium they're not supposed to have anyway, doesn't stop them from enriching uranium as the UN has demanded since 2006. doesn't stop a breakout capacity, doesn't provide for more intrusive UN inspections, the most that the IAEA wants. And look, some experts say they could possibly have a bomb in 33 days if they want, and it doesn't send any equipment to the U.S. government facility in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, like Libya did. Does one screw, one nail, one piece move from Tehran to Tennessee, like Libya South America, completely dismantled their facilities?
No. Now, the administration says this is just an interim deal, but the fact is terms of interim deals have a way of becoming permanent. And in fact, the biggest concession that the United States made in this interim deal is also indicated to be a concession in the final deal as well, and that is that Iran will continue to enrich uranium. This document, published earlier today, says that in the final arrangement there will be a mutually agreed upon uranium enrichment program for Iran. Uranium enrichment is the long pole in the tent of any nuclear weapons program, and we have conceded that Iran can continue to enrich uranium. The rest of this, frankly, is window dressing, and Iran knows it.
What about Javad Zarif? The foreign minister's claim that they have an inherent right to enrich uranium, like any country.
Sure. Look, this has been a weapons program for 20 years. It's never been anything other than a nuclear weapons program. You'd have to be delusional to think that Iran has now reversed its 20 to 25 year long objective of getting nuclear weapons. And you can have all the rhetoric you want. You know, you hear John Kerry talk about a fail-safe program. There's never been a fail-safe arms control agreement in history. They talk about, in this interim deal, freezing Iran's nuclear program. You know, to most Americans, freeze means stop. It's not being stopped. Its expansion is being stopped, but it's continuing at its existing levels while the sanctions are being relieved and while the edifice of the sanctions, the political will to hold the sanctions together, collapses. You know, the senators talked this morning about imposing new sanctions in Congress. They think they'll get that over an Obama administration veto. We're on the downhill slope here, I'm afraid to say.
And finally, Ambassador, what do you predict will happen in 6 months from now? May 24th? A comprehensive agreement, will they break it?
Well, I think it would be to Iran's advantage here to move very, very swiftly, make some more tactical, superficial concessions, and really deal a death blow to what's left of the sanctions regime. I think what this does is turn the spotlight back on Israel, because if they don't take military action very soon, it is essentially 100% the case that Iran will get nuclear weapons, and it won't stop with Iran. Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Turkey, and perhaps others will as well. This is the opening gun of a nuclear arms race in the Middle East.
Chilling words from Ambassador John Bolton this morning, the opening gun in a arms race in the Middle East. Ambassador, always good to see you, and thank you so much for your analysis.
Thank you, Eric.